Welcome Yamhill County to Speaking Frankly. I'm your host, Howie Harkema, and our tagline is, "And how we doin'?" Today, my guest is Dave Adams, who's the owner and operator of KLYC Radio, AM 1260 on your radio dial. Welcome, Dave.
Glad to be here. Thank you.
Thank you for being on Speaking Frankly. Today, we get to learn about radio on a TV show.
Well, we should.
Yes. So I'm going to read this little preface here. KLYC Radio, 1260 Radio, originally founded in 1949 by Jack and Jeb Bladine. KLYC has had many call signs and owners over its history in Yamhill County and ceased broadcasting and signed off last on Friday, March 22, 2013 at 1 p.m. playing the Traveling Wilburys song, End of the Line. And then you stepped in and saved the day.
Oh, well, thank you. It was an honor and a privilege, and it's something that I've done since high school, since 1978. Started in a work-study class in high school. There's an interesting story there.
I bet.
High school kids like to have free periods. And so I signed up for this because it was a free period. And the school was supposed to get you a job. Well, they came to us a week and said, "You have a week to find your own job or you're out of the class." So, you know, being the industrious, very hardworking high school student that I was,
I'm sure
I wanted that free period. So the instructor came up to me one day and said, "Well, there's a radio station that wants somebody to play the commercials during high school football games. Would you be interested and you could stay in the class?" And I thought, sure, I could do that. I'd never, ever thought of being in radio, very shy in high school. And being in front of the class was almost like going to the dentist.
Mm-hmm.
And so thinking of a career in broadcasting simply wasn't on my radar screen. I was going to be an electronics technician and repair televisions.
Uh-huh.
So I got into radio, terrified the first night, just knew I could push the wrong button and blow up the transmitter. And of course that didn't happen. And had a blast at it, and I decided not to go to college and stayed and worked at the radio station. The morning show host was killed in a motorcycle accident.
Oh my.
And so my senior year of high school, I was working full-time at the radio station. And
well, anything to get out of free, have a free period.
Yeah. Little did I know that was...
And now it's a lifelong career.
Of working very hard.
So how long have you and your wife, Norma, now owned KLYC Radio AM 1260 here in McMinnville?
It's been almost 4 years now. It's a great community. One of the things that I believe strongly in is community radio.
Mm-hmm.
Radio that, or media, it can be newspaper, television, radio, but radio is my area of expertise and what I love to do. You've got to be involved in the community.
Right.
And it's very key for radio stations to be successful today because there are so much competition out there. The term I'll use is called market fragmentation.
Mm-hmm.
Essentially what that means is there's so many things to take your ears and your eyeballs away from what it used to be. When you and I were growing up, you would go home and you would watch the network news. It would be either CBS, NBC, or ABC.
Right.
And it was either Walter Cronkite or the others.
Yes.
You know, most of us liked Walter Cronkite. And that was where you got your information.
Right.
Now you have Twitter, you have smartphones, you have
YouTube,
you have everything. You have, and it is added to daily almost. It's interesting, sometimes you'll walk on the street in McMinnville and they'll say, "Are you on whatever service?" And I'll say, "I've never heard of that one before." So the market fragmentation is, there's so many things for you to do to entertain and inform you that it's putting a lot of pressure on traditional media,
right,
to be competitive and to be relevant in today's society and to get those eyeballs and those ears back to where they were.
But speaking of relevance, you do have a website.
Yes.
And you also have a Facebook page.
Yes, we do.
And so, Paul, if you would bring up that banner, that would be great. And you also have a phone, so people can call you out there and request songs or talk to you, advertisers can get in touch with you, and blah, blah, blah.
Yes. So what we decided to do was, and quite frankly, I'll speak candidly, there were some people that were telling me that I was insane to buy a 1,000-watt AM radio station in a small rural town in Oregon. That's not where the industry is headed. If you look at the standards, or if you look at the data that the polling companies are doing, it shows that radio broadcasting is, it's still, you know, 60 to 70% of Americans still use radio. But as far as the growth, and when you look at growth, that's really important, because what's going to be happening in 10 years from today?
Right.
Radio is pretty much flatlined. That's not meaning that it's dead. It's meaning that there's no significant growth. The areas that are growing are the internet, streaming, those kinds of things, satellite radio.
Sure.
Those alternative medias that have come on with new technology, that's where a lot of people are headed to, and that's the area of significant growth.
Yeah, I can understand that. Newspapers have the same problem.
Yes.
And I would think that the most important part of radio today is drive time.
Yeah, morning drive and afternoon.
Right.
Noon and afternoon when they're going home.
Right. So when did you begin broadcasting at KLYC back in the day?
Oh, it was about 4 years ago. We signed it on at the grain station.
Uh-huh.
We had a big switch that we threw. And we signed it on at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. It was signed off at 1 o'clock to represent 1260 as being the nearest
sure.
thing to 1 o'clock. And we signed back on with the song Cool in the Gang Celebration. And we just wanted to make a statement.
Sure.
And we also had a positioning statement, a marketing statement. I think the one you have here is, how we doing?
Yeah.
So we started saying, and I just, sometimes my best marketing statements are just flippant comments.
I understand.
I make. And I said, you're back in Mac and here to stay. And that kind of caught on. And we used that as a positioning statement for quite a while. Because it was meant to make a statement that we were engaged and going forward, and we're not here to go out of business. We're here to stay in business.
Well, local radio is really important to Yamhill County. A lot of people get their information from local radio. And when it went off the air, there was a huge void, and everyone realized it. So you really came in, and you and Norma became a hero for Yamhill County for
well,
this.
We appreciate that. There was some interesting things that happened. We did our due diligence. Due diligence means when you want to buy something, specifically something as money and time consuming as a radio station, you do your background, you do your homework, you open the hood and make sure that you know all the problems that could arise and try to find them.
So tell that story.
So in our due diligence study in Yamhill County, we found that people, one of the things that we did not want was we did not want to be a Portland suburb. I didn't want to compete in the Portland market. I'm not a big fan of major market radio. I like small town radio.
Sure.
Example, Lemonade Day in McMinnville. We're running around talking to kids doing lemonade stands. That is community radio at its best. And that's what we like to do. That kind of radio probably won't work well in Portland.
Right, rural.
But
totally different.
Yeah, it will in a small Oregon town.
Right.
So that's what we're looking for. So initially we weren't favorably impressed with McMinnville, because before I did my research, I thought, well, it's just a suburb of Portland, and they're more interested in major market stuff. And I'm not really interested in major market radio. But when we came here, we found that people didn't care about Portland. They cared about Lemonade Day. They cared about what's going on in Main Street McMinnville.
Farm Fest, Harvest Fest at the Heritage Center,
yeah.
All of that. Kids on the Block.
Yes.
Lots of things.
So we said, you know, this could be a good fit. This is the kind of radio that would be received well in the market, that I believe advertisers would support, and we'd have fun at, and it would be a fit. And so we decided to do it. We bought it for $50,000. They were pretty motivated to sell, because they were about ready to just kind of piece it out in a yard sale.
Literally. Oh, really?
And the license was just going to be allowed to go dormant and be revert back to the FCC for whoever wanted it.
Right.
It would have probably been moved to Portland if we had not taken it. So that's, you know, we decided to, one of the things that happened when we turned it on, when we started testing it, had been off for 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
Turned the transmitter back on and started putting test tones, started putting music on it. The phone started to ring the minute we turned the transmitter on. And people said, "You've come back." And I said, "You've got to be kidding. Have you been listening to static for 3 months?" And they said, "Yes, we left it on in the garage and we hoped that somehow, some way, it would come back to life." And I turned to the other person and said, "Be careful what you're saying on the air because people are listening." Typically that doesn't happen.
Yeah.
Typically it's a dead station, all your listeners have gone away and they're not listening. But they were. They were listening to static on the off chance that somehow it would come back on.
That's how important it is.
And I turned to Norma and I said, "I think we made a good choice here."
Yep.
They're listening to the station when it's not even on the air.
Well, you told me a couple stories about being a broadcaster the other day when we were talking. And would you like to talk about some of the places that you broadcasted from?
Yeah, it's been a very fun career. I've met a lot of interesting people. We were talking about in the setup of the studio here, we were talking about the sound caused by the air conditioner. I was involved in an interview with in Malheur County, which is over on the eastern side of the state. 60 Minutes, Harry Reasoner came over and did a story about what a training a judge goes through, a district court judge, from an attorney to a practicing city district court judge.
Interesting.
And so they followed a man who at that time was my brother-in-law. And they made them shut down the entire air conditioning system for the courthouse, including the jail.
Oh, my.
Or the producer refused to film the show. And it caused a lot of problems, and a facility that large to just shut it down because it was a summer day.
Yeah.
And that was an interesting, you know, there was a lot of raised eyebrows.
I'm sure of it.
But 60 Minutes has a lot of pull.
Yes, they do.
So they were able to shut it down. Other things, I was in broadcasting in New Zealand.
Yes.
That was an interesting, there was a lot more regulation in the United States than New Zealand as far as making sure that the station is operating correctly. And that was an interesting experience. I was broadcasting from a shipping container in sunny Nelson. And that was a great experience, both personally and from a business standpoint. One of the problems we ran into in New Zealand was prejudice.
Mm.
Nobody would advertise on my radio station because I was a Yank.
Really?
Not a single person in town would buy a penny of advertising. And they said, we don't have anything against you personally, but because you're an American, you're a Yank, we're not going to do business with you.
But they want the tourist dollars.
They want the tourist dollars, but you're not one of us, and we're not going to support you.
Goodness.
And so I had to go back home. So that was, I've never experienced prejudice on that scale before.
Mm-hmm.
And I ended up working at a pack house stacking apples. If you ever go into a grocery store and there's an apple with a word Enza on it, E-N-Z-A, comes from a pack house in Stoke, New Zealand, and I worked on that line. So it's interesting, every once in a while I go to a store and see if there's any Enza apples there. I was in the best shape of my life. I was riding a bicycle, throwing 60-pound boxes of apples 10 feet high, 8 hours a day.
Oh my.
And I was in pretty good shape.
After not working out as a broadcaster there, goodness. So how many transmission watts does KLYC currently have during the daytime?
We have 1,000 watts during the daytime, 900 watts directional at night. Remember, I don't know if we did it on camera, but at nighttime, AM radio waves travel farther distances. I'll make this very short and sweet. There's a layer of the atmosphere called the ionosphere that contracts or shrinks when it cools down.
Sure.
And radio waves bounce off that. And when it comes closer to the Earth, the radio waves will bounce farther because they have less distance to travel. So at nighttime, we have to reduce power and go on what's called a pattern. And on the negative or null points of that pattern, is a competing station on the same frequency, and we have to protect that. So pretend you have a hot air balloon here, or just a balloon filled with air, and you squish it down. More of the energy will go to the area that's not squished down, and this the part you're squishing down is the null point. Well, when if you look at an AM system like ours, we have two towers, and those towers work together in how we send the signal to them, how they're physically located in respect to one another, to create this pattern. And we have two null points, a north and south null point. There's a station in Washington State at 1270 that we have to protect. When we bought the station, that system had not been functioning for, I don't know how long, it wasn't functioning when we bought it. We had to fix that. The cost, the estimated cost to fix that was $100,000. The engineer friend of mine and I fixed it for about $65,000, I think is what it was.
Well, that's a substantial savings.
It was not an easy task. There were some challenges that we ran into.
So when you're tuning in on AM on your radio dial, you sometimes get cross between two stations that seem to almost overlap each other. Is that what the that you're talking about, that pattern?
There's a number of different things that can happen when this happens. Signal bounce, there's some mixing of the signals possibly in the receiver that happens. There's just a number of things that can cause that kind of thing happening.
Yeah. So what is KLYC's reach?
We go all the way from Lebanon, Albany up to about Beaverton. It starts to get scratchy when you get that far out.
Sure.
But we cover Yamhill County. So our principal cities of coverage are all the cities in Yamhill County, as well as Independence, Monmouth, and Dallas and Polk County. We go up to Wilhelmina, Sheridan. That's about as far west as we want to go. McMinnville, Amity, Dayton, Newburgh, of course, YC. Yeah. Those are the primary cities we cover.
So what are some of the challenges that you've been involved in this type of operation, Dave?
As far as technically?
Yeah, technically.
We ran into some, when we were fixing, we ran into a lot of them. I've been involved in a lot of technical projects since 1978. Of all the projects I've run into, this was number two on the difficulty scale.
Wow.
And it never wanted to give up. There was always a way to do it, but there was it was pretty it was difficult. We ran into some challenges. One of the challenges we ran into was in fixing the array. We had to totally gut it, throw all the parts out, rebuild it, and essentially start over again. One of the things that happened when we did that is it had been a long time since anybody had taken measurements demonstrating the fact that the pattern was in compliance.
And you have to do that.
Yeah. So we had no benchmark to gauge when it was fixed. So we went out and took the readings at the points on the license that were described that we were supposed to do that. We got it dialed in, and those readings were way out of line, especially the monitor point in Lafayette on Bridge Street. What happened was, in the period of time from whenever those readings were taken until now, one of the things that had happened was there was a lot of cell towers that were erected.
Sure.
Cell towers have a tendency to bounce or reflect AM radio waves because they're about the same height as an AM tower.
Sure.
In Lafayette, there's three towers, if not four, that are pretty close to our AM tower. And those were reflecting a lot of signal into the Bridge Street monitor point. So what that happens is it pollutes or dirties that monitor point. What that means is the reading you're getting isn't truly reflective of what you're broadcasting. It's measuring some signal reflection from those being bounced off those cell towers.
Sure, that makes sense.
A lot of AM broadcasters are running into that, and so they developed this very expensive alternative, which is called the moment method proof. Essentially, it's you take a lot of electrical measurements of your tower, you put it in a computer model, and you demonstrate theoretically that you're on pattern,
right,
that you're doing the balloon in the correct way to protect the station in Washington State and one down south. because the monitor points can't be trusted because there's so much signal bounce going on.
You can't find out
the truth. You're not getting an accurate signal.
Right.
Or actual measurement at the monitor point.
Yeah.
So that took some money, and that took some time. Time equals money in business.
Yeah.
And so it took... One of the questions we were being asked was, it's sure taking a long time to fix this. Well, it was broken. And we had to come in some ways to re-engineer it.
Right.
And we did.
And that's the most important part right there. And that's why I asked the question about what are the challenges, because mm-hmm. I knew you had a bunch.
We did. I want to give thank you to a gentleman by the name of James Boyd.
Yeah.
James Boyd is a broadcaster in the Beaverton area, or a radio engineer. I've worked with James for about 30 years now. I can't be that old.
No.
No. And James and I've been involved with some very difficult projects with James. This was probably the most difficult. There was another one in Idaho that I won't even talk about, but if you have some listeners or viewers that are interested in the technical aspects of propagation of radio, an on-site amplifier where you've got two transmitters operating on the same frequency on an FM station broadcasting to a city from two different points at the same time and have them listenable is a trick. And that's hard to do. That was the most challenging project. That was in Idaho. We won't have time
to talk about that. It sounds like misalignment could be a problem there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So... you seem to be everywhere these days. Everywhere I go, I seem to see your new van, your new KLYC van. How do you like the new van?
We love the new van. The old van was very iconic, loved by everybody in Yamhill County.
Everybody loved it.
But it wouldn't run. And whenever we would take it out on the street, we would have to either get it towed or it would limp back to the station. Whenever it would rain... we would have to cover the equipment inside the van. The floor was rusted. There was this white powdery stuff. I don't know if it was mold or rust or a combination thereof that would get in all of our equipment.
Oh, no, not good.
And it just had some problems. And when you would raise your head in it, you would, because it was just the old 1972 Dodge van,
right.
You would hit your head. And on some of those seams... in the top of the van, you could split your head open because it was just the metal seam that was kind of jagged. So it was difficult to work in. The biggest problem was the leaks in the rain.
I bet.
And the fact that it wouldn't run.
And you've got sensitive equipment in there.
There's nothing worse than being in a parade and having to be towed.
So Dave, you've made many, many community connections and networked really hard to get your business really aligned to grow. How's it going for you now after 4 years?
It's going very well. One of the things that I love about rural Oregon, I was born in Ontario, so I've grown up in a community similar to this size.
Sure.
People see that you're engaged and you're working hard and they support you.
Yeah.
It's small town America and I love it. Born, raised in small town America, that's what this is, and there's a lot of positive things to be said for it. There's a lot of support in the community. They want a radio station. It's the only commercially licensed broadcast radio station in the entire county.
Right.
And it's important from an emergency broadcast part of it to tell people what's going on
exactly.
In the emergency. We are the only radio station in the Salem, Oregon operational area with a dedicated broadcast, with a generator, dedicated generator at the transmitter site. If we went off the air right now, we'd have to go out there and start it.
Fire it up.
Yep. But there's a generator there full of gas ready to go. And that will be the only station you'll hear in the Salem area.
That's amazing. So how many days a week is KLYC on the air?
24/7.
That's what I thought. And how many remotes do you do, and how do you decide how your available schedule is going to work for those remotes?
Very good question. We were talking about market fragmentation
right.
earlier, and so AM, back to the story about Dave, you're a nut. Why are you buying an AM radio station in today's
marketplace
sure. where nobody's listening to AM radio? Nobody listens to AM radio anymore.
But Yamhill County does.
Yes, they do, thankfully. So what do? You position yourself as being You find out what the market wants and you satisfy it.
Right.
Remember, we did our due diligence. We came in. They liked local news. They liked local involvement. They like, you know, interviews with Lemonade Day with kids and so on and so forth. So we rebrand it. We call it the new AM radio, always mobile. So we get a big van that we can stand up in, which is what we did, and we're on the street all the time.
Yep.
There are times we're parked doing, you know, paperwork and stuff like that, but most of the broadcasting is done on location because you want to be out where the people are, engaging them. That's what you do, is you take radio station back to the street.
Right.
One of the things that happened in broadcasting, to the detriment of broadcasting, is when the, and this is just my personal opinion, when the FCC allowed large companies to buy up radio stations all over the all over the country, they created an homogenized, non-creative template radio station that is devoid of local reactions to the marketplace. They killed their creativity in radio when they allowed that to happen, and I fault the FCC with that. I think they, to some extent, are to be blamed for the death, or I don't want to say the death of radio, but it killed a lot of incentive and a lot of creativity in the local marketplace.
Right.
I don't think that was a good move for radio.
I don't believe so either.
And because in the old days you would have ownership rules that would prevent major companies from buying up these stations. And so what you would have is you would have a local radio station that was extremely local because it lived there. It lived and it breathed there and it reacted with the local environment. It wasn't being programmed out of Dallas, Texas.
It was organic.
Yes. So what you have today is sometimes in major market radio stations, you have a guy sitting in Boston who's doing a show for Dallas, Seattle, San Francisco, and Los Angeles. And he's just there cranking out voice track announcements for the songs. And he doesn't know how to pronounce the street names in Boston, but he's got to talk to an audience in Boston. How does that work? It doesn't work too well.
So we have about 3 minutes left, Dave.
Oh, boy.
And I know it all goes by so quick. Would you like to talk about your online presence on KLYC US, which is your online?
One of the things that we're doing is we want to be engaged with our audience, and we want to be there where they are, which is on the internet.
Right.
The smartphone is the new Walkman.
Sure.
So we have a number of internet radio stations. One is called Operation Eagle's Wings, or the Eagle. We're reaching out to veterans. We have a classic Western station called Bunkhouse Radio that Eric Elliott in the local area helps us program. We're going to be doing some more. We're going to be reaching out to local school districts and helping them in starting their own radio station. The first one is going to be an online radio station in Dayton, Oregon.
Wow.
And we're going to be starting that probably next week.
That's awesome.
And we're going to be teaching these kids how to do radio. And we're pretty excited about that. It's part of the Innovate Dayton and the Innovate Oregon project. So we want to be online. We want to be online podcasting, video web streaming, and a bunch of other things. Stay tuned. As I say, watch this space.
So I have two last questions, and you only have about 30 seconds to answer each of them. You guys at KLYC are our local emergency radio information provider for the entire county.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean to you if an emergency arises?
We are working very closely with the county. We're working very closely with the amateur radio group called ARES, the Amateur Radio Emergency Service. We're developing and wanting to work with the county in changing some areas of the local county emergency response plan that we see some issues with.
Right.
We want to be able to get information from the county. The county, with current administration, wants to work with us to fix those areas.
Good.
We're going to be working with AM operators, and that's how we're going to get information from the county to us. We have a backup generator. We also have a plan if the towers fall because of a major earthquake to get something back up in the air so that we can get back on the air.
Right.
We are working on getting a workable, reliable plan that will work in an emergency.
Well, I'm going to have to get you back on here again and do another half hour with you because I did not finish all these questions.
I talked too much.
No, it's all good. we learned a lot today. But what makes your day? What makes your day here in Yamhill County?
What makes my day is when I get a phone call, and I've gotten several of them, saying, I'm sure glad you came back to Yamhill County. I love what you've done with the local radio station. Keep doing everything you're doing. That's what makes my day.
Awesome. Thank you, Dave, very much for being on today. And thank you, Yamhill County, for watching Speaking Frankly.